Hello, options traders. Welcome, everyone, and happy Friday. I know we have a lot of people in here that are trading ETFs, and for good reasons. Very popular choice. We can do a lot of option strategies. Really, anything that we can do with shares of stock, we can do with an ETF. But there's a fairly new player on the scene called an ETN. And in some ways, they're very similar, but there's also some very big differences that you need to be aware of. So let's take a look at ETFs versus ETNs. All right, so what's an ETF? Well, it's very simply an exchange-traded fund. And they came out in 1993, so they've definitely been around for a while. But you can think of them as a mutual fund that trades like a stock. So as long as the financial markets are open, you can buy an ETF. That's not true for a mutual fund. Mutual funds only trade one time during the day. There are some exceptions that have two, possibly even three settlements during the day, but most of them trade once. Now, one of the big distinctions of an ETF, just like a mutual fund, is that it actually owns the shares. The company that creates this ETF physically goes out and owns these shares, just like a mutual fund. But the way they go about it is very different. And this is what sets up some of the benefits. So with an ETF, what they do is they hire another financial firm, could be a bank or a big financial intermediary like a Lehman Brothers or somebody. And that's what's called the authorized agent. And it is only this authorized agent that can increase the ETF shares. They can actually add more shares to the pool. And the authorized agent can also decrease the number of shares out there. But only the authorized agent can do this. So let's take a look at how shares are created, and then we'll look at why they use this method. So here we've got the ETF company on the left. We've got the authorized agent on the right. And the ETF comes up with a buy list, and they'll say, we're trying to create a fund that does this. Maybe it's the S&P 500. And here's the list of stocks that we need and in the right proportions. And so they send this list to the authorized agent, and the authorized agent goes out and buys these stocks, and it turns around and sends them to the ETF. And the ETF, in exchange, sends them a share of an ETF. So again, this is kind of called the create mode or a creation of an ETF share. And in this little example here, we have created one share of the ETF. Well, the authorized agent can also destroy or eliminate shares. So the way that it does this is it simply hands over an ETF share to the ETF company. And the ETF company in exchange says, here's this basket of shares that you originally sent us. And so if the authorized agent does this, then it has reduced the shares of the ETF. Now, by having this arrangement, you can probably see that it sets up the scenario where the ETF shares might actually trade for a little different value than the actual basket of shares. And so it sets up what's called an arbitrage. And so let's say that the shares in the open market are actually trading for a little bit higher price than the shares of the ETF. What's going to happen? Well, the authorized agent is going to recognize this and it's going to sell short the shares in the open market, just do a regular short sale. And to cover this sale, they're going to turn in some shares of the ETF. The ETF in turn sends back actual shares. They use those shares to cover the shorts. And again, this has a downward pressure on those share prices. But notice that they've also turned in shares of the ETF. So now we have fewer shares of the ETF, and that tends to boost its price. And guess what happens? The ETF starts trading for very close to the price of the actual shares in the market. The opposite can occur as well. Let's say if the share prices are down, the authorized agent comes in and buys these shares. That tends to push the prices up. And then they turn these shares over to the ETF in exchange for shares. That increases the number of shares in the float, and that tends to push the ETF price down. And again, the ETF is trading for very, very close to what the shares are trading for in the open market. So one function of the authorized agent is to ensure that the shares of the ETF actually represent what's happening in the market. And because it's an arbitrage, there's a profit incentive to do so. But the bigger reason for having an authorized agent is it creates what's called an in-kind transfer. So notice that in my example here, the ETF and the authorized agent are simply exchanging shares back and forth. No money's changing hands. Okay, so there's no sales or exchange of cash. And because of that, there are no capital gains. It is possible that the ETF may distribute some capital gains through the year, but it's fairly rare. For the most part, your ETF does not distribute capital gains. So the first big benefit that you get as an investor is that the ETFs are tax deferred. It does not mean that they are tax avoided. You will ultimately pay taxes on any gains, but the big point is that you get to determine. You get to actually say when those taxes are triggered. Now, I said earlier that an ETF is very similar to a mutual fund, and conceptually they are. But the mutual fund actually goes out and owns the shares, and it distributes capital gains at the end of the year. So look at the difference here. If you owned a mutual fund that maybe otherwise did exactly the same thing, it's going to distribute capital gains each year. So as an example, let's say that we have a mutual fund trading for $10 and it earns 10%. So at the end of the year, the fund is trading for $11. What's going to happen is it's going to distribute that $1 capital gain, and you have to pay it whether you like it or not. They just distribute it and it becomes a capital gain to you. And in response, the fund turns around and starts trading for $10 again. It's very much like when a stock pays a dividend. It's paid out some cash, and so the fund is trading for 10. So this can go back and forth every single year. But take a look at how different it is with the ETF. We're gonna use an ETF that is exactly the same structure, trading for 10 bucks, earns 10%, it's trading for 11, and it's gonna sit there. If you wish to sell, then you will pay the dollar capital gain, but not everybody else. If you don't sell it, then you'll defer the capital gain. And so from an investing standpoint, the longer you defer, the better, because of the time value of money. It's getting cheaper and cheaper to pay those taxes back. All right, so what's an ETF drawback? Well, the biggest drawback of the ETF is that it gets what's called tracking errors. And from the process that I described before, it should be obvious that the basket of shares in the open market are probably not going to trade for exactly the same price as the ETF. Another problem is that the ETF may not own exactly the same number of shares in exactly the same proportions. So if they do an ETF on the S&P 500, technically there's 503 tickers in there now, but they might say, look, some of these stocks are so small and represent such a small proportion. Let's just kind of ignore them. We don't really want to own such a large basket of stocks. And it's still going to track very, very closely, but not perfectly. So let's say if the index is up 10% at the end of the year, you might find that this ETF is up 9.98%. It'll be close, but it won't be perfect. And the reason is tracking errors. Another problem with tracking errors is that they might be small over a short run, a year or two, but if you're holding on to this thing for 10 or 20 or 30 years in an IRA, the tracking errors can definitely add up. So those are the basic benefits and drawbacks of an ETF. What about an ETN? Well, it is an exchange-traded note. And as I said earlier, it's a fairly recent development. These came out in 2006. But it's called a note because that's what it is. It's actually a bond, usually issued for 10 to 30 years. They have a maturity. Think of it like an expiration date. ETFs do not. So the person that issues an ETN is actually borrowing money. And there's absolutely no ownership of shares. And just like an ETF, there's no capital gains. Instead, what happens is that the ETN pays off the performance of the index minus expenses. So maybe it says we're going to track whatever. It could be a commodity, could be an index. And at the end of this, let's say a 10-year period, it's up 50 or 60, 70%. Whatever the number is, that's what it's going to pay off. So it's very simple. What did it pay off? This is what we owe. And so there's really no ownership of shares and again, no capital gains. It's just simply promising to pay off the performance of some underlying. So what's the benefit here? Well, there's no tracking errors because it's not physically buying and selling these shares. Another benefit is that it gives you access to niche products. You could really do it on anything that can generate a number. See, with an ETF, you have to physically go out and buy the shares. So it has to be something that's tradable. ETNs could trade currencies, they could trade commodities, they at least can certainly do it a whole lot easier than you can through an ETF. Now, what's the big ETN drawback? Well, it's a bond, and that means the issuer may default. This is the big one. So even though it might be unlikely, you have to understand it is a bond, and this person has borrowed money. when Lehman went under, I think there was at least one, maybe two of the ETNs that they had issued. And they went under. Actually, investors lost money. They didn't lose everything on them. But the point is, it was a big name, Lehman, and they went under. So just be careful of that. If you're looking at an ETN, understand that it is a bond. So hopefully that gives you some insights into the advantages and disadvantages of the ETFs and ETNs. But no matter which one you choose, options can magnify the gains and they can reduce the losses. If you'd like to learn more about the art and science of options trading, please check out the Alpha Trader course and Strategy Lab at optionsa-z.com. You can also find some mini courses such as the Greeks and volatility. Also, please join us on the Facebook trading group Options A to Z, and you can find a link in the description below.